continue to worship today, church. I count on one thing. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy.
Welcome to Parkway. I'm so glad that you guys are joining us today. I invite you to stand to your feet this morning. I know it's still a little different. We're all kind of spread out a little bit. But that's all good because we're still one family. We can worship together. We can sing about the victories that we have in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's sing together.
And I heard an old story and how a Savior came from the glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. And I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. And then I repented of my sins and won the victory.
Streets in deep love, he loved me,
give a shout of hallelujah. Amen. We have victory this morning.
Amen. Isn't it awesome to be in church and sing about victory? And praise the Lord. You guys can sit down for a moment. What in the world does it mean when I give announcements? Well, I don't disappoint you, but I'm going to preach today, okay? Bubba, he had a little accident, got something stuck in his foot, but tell you what, this is the way to start church rumors. Let's just think that he maybe got in a bulldozer accident or something. This is the way to start rumors, guys. So now he got something stuck in his foot, so he's going to remain home and get that dialed in. So he didn't want to be distracting today. So I'll give you your announcements. I want you guys to just stay plugged in. We got a lot of announcements, some exciting things, some new things that are changing. So I want you guys to make sure you're paying attention for those. You guys know that we've been doing office hours just a little bit different during this virus. And the reason is we spent time in the office, and then we're able to get people's groceries or medicines to help people out in the evening. That's kind of waned off just a little bit here in the past couple weeks just because of everything's kind of opening back up. So what we're going to do is go back into regular office hours. We actually did this about a week or two ago, but we're going to go again 8:30 to 4:30. So if you guys need us, we'll be here. This Monday, however, because it is what? Awesome. Yeah, Memorial Day, we're going to be celebrating that, so we'll have the offices closed. But just want you guys to know we're here for you. We'll be available. Just call in. Miss Linda will make sure she can grab me and Bubba and make sure we're there at whatever appointment we need to. I do want to thank you guys for your tithes and offerings. I'm so thankful that we have a flexible church. You guys have given through. You've seen me in Walmart. You've given me checks. You have dropped it off at drive-ins. You've mailed it in. You've done online. You've texted. You've done everything. And I'm just so thankful that you guys were flexible with that. We've seen a constant, steady giving heart. And me and Bubba were talking about that we get to pastor a church that is just consistent and awesome in that area. So thank you guys for that. Just to give you an update, how when we leave, we're going to leave just like we did last week. I'm going to dismiss by sections. You can go outside in the parking lot and kind of gather there, but we've got to clean the sanctuary for the Hispanic church. But as you exit, we'll have our offering plates there. That way we don't have to pass everybody's nastiness around, if that's okay with you guys. One update with our ladies' ministries, and I've been really thankful that our ministries have kind of adapted to this time. They just didn't shut down. We didn't say, all right, well, coronavirus, we can't do anything. So some of our ministries that are just adapting are the ladies' ministry. And we're calling this ladies' ministry, I think it's called Ladies of Grace. Is that correct? Women of Grace. I'm never going to get it right. So they're something, women have grace, something like that. Anyways, they're meeting on Zoom June 4th. They've been having really, really good results from that. I know my wife was able to plug into one of those. So they're going to do a Zoom meeting, real awesome time to get together with a bunch of women and just pray together and study Scripture. Do that across Zoom. If you need to see Miss Paula or Courtney Chilson, they get you dialed in for that. It's pretty easy to use, honestly. Next is they're going to have, I think it's the 13th of June, they're actually going to start getting back together and doing the ladies' brunches. I know my wife really enjoyed doing that. So they're going to do that at somebody's house. So again, if you want to be plugged into that, kids are welcome, they say, so just talk to Miss Paula for that. If you guys know, speaking of kids, VBS is coming up. Melanie has stress and worry and tiredness all over her face. And during this May time, she always looks like that. It's because of VBS. And I'm so thankful that we have a children's pastor that's passionate about that. And I think I told the story right in the first service that you got saved out of VBS. And so VBS is really, really important for you. So if you want to help Melanie out, I'm sure that she wouldn't turn down that help. Come by the office and just offer. She's painting stuff, creating stuff, making sure she can have an awesome environment for these kids to come seek the Lord. But VBS, again, is June 10th through 12th, and we're going to be able to have that. So just spread those words for us and begin praying for that. On Wednesday nights, how many of you guys have been enjoying the drive-in service? Isn't that kind of neat? So several of you guys, even we're allowed to do a little bit more right now, and I think we're doing it smart. We're cleaning things. But a lot of you guys like the drive-in service, even if we didn't have coronavirus. It just was kind of a cool, fun thing to do in the summer. So what we're going to try is this summer, we're going to keep going with the drive-in service. The only negative I see, there's two negatives to drive-in service. Sometimes the sun is directly in your eyeballs, and you're mad as a hornet the whole time you're trying to listen to me preach. And the second thing is if it rains. And so it's not that we're fair weather fans. We don't want to ruin our sound system. Jacob gets kind of emotional when he thinks about his sound system getting all wet and stuff. So we don't want to do that. It'll ruin thousands of dollars for the sound equipment. They don't play real nice with the moisture. So if it rains, stay plugged in with FlockNote. If you guys are not plugged in, if you're not getting our church emails or church text messages, please come see me. That way we can make adjustments and change like that. I want to give you an announcement in terms of camp. Remember last week we said we were going to have a camp board meeting, and I wanted to kind of lean on the camp board as to whether we're going to make a decision to open up camp. And so we met together Saturday, we prayed together, and what we did is we voted unanimously to open up camp this year. So super excited about that. I had some open-ended comments before church about if we're going to have camp or not, but yes, we're voting to have camp. I think people need camp. I think people need to go up the mountain. We need to hear from the Lord. We need to make sure that we're doing that in community. We are going to make some adjustments just to make sure that we're safe. I think there's no reason not to do that during this time. So making those adjustments, but stay tuned for that. In terms of camp, we're a little bit behind in terms of maintenance. So if you guys could help me, on Tuesdays, every single Tuesday, we're taking a lot of the church and school staff, and we're going to go up and we're going to clean and redo stuff. Because last year we had a couple months jump on it. This year we're just a little bit behind. So if you guys want to plug in and come help us, I'll have projects for everybody from kids to seasoned saints. So if you want to come up on Tuesdays, we'll be there pretty much all day. And then May 30th, which is next Saturday, we're going to have a work day. We're going to try to do about half a day, maybe spill over a little bit into the evening. And then June 27th will be a big day. We're going to set up the tent. So stay tuned for that. Camp is July 5th through 11th. I do want to let you know that about these services. I'm so thankful to see you guys. I'm thankful that we get to act like a community again. Many people said, are we going to keep doing these two services for the rest of the year? And I just don't like that. I like being a family. What I've been telling people is, in essence, do you have two family meals at your house? You have one. Why? Because you love everybody. So I would love to get everybody back in the same room. We're probably going to keep doing this format at least until July. If something changes and we're able to go back to one and we feel safe with that, we'll let you know. But right now, this is working. Everybody's safe. It's not distracting. So we're going to keep doing that until July. Sunday school, however, I'm so thankful for this church. That you guys love Sunday school. You haven't figured out that Sunday school is dead and it's not popular. The Sunday school ministries are just thriving at Parkway. The classes are growing. But we're going to start opening back up those classes in June 14th. So I've talked to all of your teachers. Everybody's comfortable with that. June 14th, we're going to open those back up. If you don't feel comfortable to come to those, don't come. If you don't feel safe, don't worry about it. However, if you feel comfortable, come and you're going to have your regular Sunday school class starting June 14th. The next thing I want to announce is what have we been fundraising for about the past 2 years? Chairs, right? So I think we should push that back another year. Do you think we should just get chairs? I think you'll need a new pastor if you push it back another year, don't you? No, chairs. We have ordered the chairs, and they will be here the first week of July. So that is exciting. Craziness has happened. Yeah. So we finally got the chairs, and we gave you guys a sneak peek, and you didn't even realize it. Remember that when we did the little newscast kind of setting where Jacob was sitting on a little stool and I preached by TV? That chair that he was sitting in, that blue, really nice chair, is actually the chairs we're buying. They sent us that sample. So what's going to happen is that first week in July, after that Sunday, we're going to take all of these chairs, we're going to take them up to camp, and these are where these chairs will go. And then we'll have our new sanctuary chairs when we come back down off the mountain. So super, super excited for that. So what is today, guys? It is the Sabbath day. We want to worship the Lord, but what is today nationally? Memorial Day. Okay, so we do want to take a moment and just honor all those who sacrificed for our freedoms, for our religious freedoms. And what I want to do is I just want to pray, and I want to invite you guys to pray with me. I want to pray that God would just touch your hearts, that today that you can worship. There's a lot of orange tape, and people are sitting all across the sanctuary. But I pray that God would just open your heart today. You'd be able to worship. Be able to sing out of an overflowing heart, that as we open up God's word, it would speak to you. But I also want to pray a prayer of thanksgiving for those who fought for our freedom and even sacrificed and died. So let's bow our heads real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, so thankful today that we get to meet together as a family. Thankful for this awesome church, for their heart for ministry, their consistent giving, their community-mindedness. Thankful that this is such an awesome church that is listening to you and growing. Pray that God, you would help us today as we seek to worship you. Pray that you be with the worship team. Help them to just worship out of an overflowing heart. I pray that, yeah, they have responsibilities. Yeah, they have to hit the right notes and do this and that. But, God, I pray that they're able to worship and that we can worship along with them, God. Pray that whole time of worship just will be honoring and glorifying to you. I pray as we open up God's word, you'd begin even right now to speak to us. You'd open up our hearts. If there's things that we need to work on or need to be challenged with or even encouraged in and solidified, I pray you begin that work even now. Father, we're thankful for those who sacrificed for our freedoms. Thankful, Father, for those who went and died so that we can be standing here today in this wonderful country worshiping you. Pray that you be with those families who have lost loved ones. Pray that you touch those wounds and those hurts. Father, we're thankful today we get to worship you and pray to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, why don't we stand up and hug each other? I'm just kidding, just kidding. Why don't we stand up and let's worship God's word, all right?
Well, I taught this song to you last week. I hope you remember it, but it's called Graves in the Gardens. And as we worship together as a body of Christ, we can just celebrate that he gives us victory over death. Amen? He gives us from life to death. Let's celebrate that. Let's sing it with all we've got. Sing it again.
And I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied. Hearing in love.
Yes, let's sing together.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Oh, I believe that's true. I'm not afraid.
Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again.
Morning to dance. Let's sing it again.
You turn morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn morning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing, yes, better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into islands. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
is worthy to be praised this morning. Every adoration, everything that we see in this world was created by Him. He created us to worship Him. So let's do that this morning. And let's just proclaim to Him that He is worthy of His name, the name that is above every name. Let us sing together.
The rumors of the Son of Man, stories of the Savior, the holiness of human hands, treasure for the traitor. No ear has heard, no eye has seen the image of the Father until heaven came to live with me.
A
rescue like no other. 'Cause you are worthy. You are. You are worthy.
Yes. Let's give him a shout of praise. He is worthy. He is sovereign over us this morning. His name is above every name. As we worship together, worship is just an act of response, right, to what he's done for us. So as we sing this next chorus of the song we know, we just can declare that his plans for us to prosper, he hasn't forgotten us. He's with us in the fire or in the coronavirus situation and the flood, but he is faithful forever. He is perfect in love, and he is sovereign over us. Let's sing this chorus together.
Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire, in the flood. Faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire, in the flood. Faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us.
He is faithful.
Faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Oh, you are sovereign over us.
Amen, church. He is worthy of worship today.
Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for your heart of worship. You may be seated. Are you guys excited to do traditional church again? Oh my goodness, I was so excited again to come this morning and realize there are going to be people here. It's like a family, and so thankful for that. Thankful for you guys with flexibility. Attendance digitally, your attendance, even though we're social distancing. It's nice to be able to come together, isn't it? You guys have transitioned very well, to be honest. Transitioned out of this staying at home, watching on Facebook. You guys don't have any pajamas on this morning, so I think it's been a very successful transition. I've seen many of you guys said you had pajamas and you had your cereal and your coffee. So you guys look good this morning, so thank you. I was talking to my mother-in-law, and she said she was actually sad to go back to regular church because she was watching this church on Facebook, and she said, well, when you said something I didn't like, I could just mute you and go into the kitchen. So I'm kind of sad to go back to regular church. So I don't know how to take that, but I guess mother-in-laws have an interesting thing. So if you're watching, Mom, mother-in-law, I'm so sorry. But now, thank you guys for your worship. Thankful for the heartfelt praise. Thankful for Jacob and leading those songs of victory. Believe we can live in victory this morning? I believe so. I think God has provided that for us. It's something that we can push forward to. I want to just recap a little bit from last week. What did we talk about last week? You guys did so much better than the first service. It's the fear of every pastor when you ask someone and they say nothing. We talked about listening. Listening. And so what we found out is that through our life, and through each day of our life, we have 7 hours of input into our ears. 7 hours every day, that's averaged across all age groups, all Americans, 7 hours of things that are inputting in our life, whether that's Facebook, social media, whether that's podcast, radio, TV, whatever it is, there's 7 hours we have inputting in our life. And we found out is that some of the psychologists are actually saying that that is really bad for us, that we're designed for one input. We found out that we're a sheep, right? And we have one shepherd. And so we need to specifically tune our hearts and minds to listen to the voice of our shepherd. But oftentimes we have so many inputs, so many things going on that oftentimes it crowds out that gentle, still voice of our shepherd. We found out if we listen to too many things, oftentimes it can actually produce something that we call PTSD. Clinical PTSD can cause anxiety, depression. It can cause many things. And we listen to those things, we realize that's the work of the enemy. We found in John 10:10, there's a thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And we listen to those things, and it ends up having death in our life and anxiety. That's the work of the enemy. But when we listen to our good shepherd, when we get alone with him in prayer, and we worship him together in community, when we read his word, guess what that produces in our life? Patience, joy, with fruits of the Spirit. And so we need to make sure that we're listening to the appropriate things. So I hope this week what you've done is you've just really dialed in and really tried to look at your life and said, you know what, I'm listening to too many things. I want to listen to the Good Shepherd. I hope you've done that. Even after preaching that, I've even found some more things in my life where I can realize, you know what, I need to turn that down. That's okay, that's a good thing, but I need to turn it down because I want to listen to the Shepherd. So this morning, I want to kind of jump off that just a little bit. I want to talk to you from Romans. So Romans chapter 13. I've been reading through Romans in my devotions, and I was kind of nervous what the Lord would talk to me about Romans, because Romans is a pretty thick book. But Romans 13 stuck out to me. So before we get started, what I want to do is I just want to spend just a moment in prayer. I want to have you guys to be able to worship, and I want you guys to pray with me, please, that if God needs to speak anything to your heart and mind right now, that He would do that, that the Holy Spirit would just be active in your life, and if there's something you need to change, you need to concrete and say, I need to keep this, or need to be encouraged in something, I would just pray right now that you would allow the Holy Spirit to do that. Dear Heavenly Father, on this Sabbath day, on this day we've just celebrated You and worshiped You. You are sovereign over us. You're worthy of all of our praise. You're here to help us. You're here to convict us, to challenge us, to encourage us. I pray that You would just begin Your work in doing that right now, Father. So thankful for Your Spirit in the first service. Thankful for the Spirit here now. Pray as we walk into Your Word that You would just encourage us, help us, and challenge us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we get started, I want to give you guys a disclaimer. You guys know that I love aviation. I love flying. And I was working on my pilot's license. We got a pilot here today, so I got to watch out for how many of the analogies I use may be incorrect. But you guys know that I love flying, and it's given me kind of endless sermon illustrations. So I just want to tell you kind of how this sermon is going to go. The wonderful thing about aviation is that the private pilot's license is you can just hop to many little different airports. And we call it the $200 hamburger, right, Randy? You start your plane, you get up in the air, and you just fly to a couple different airports, and they have little restaurants there. Went to one that was called Cloud 9, and you can get a 172 wet, which means it's a Philly cheesesteak with sauce on it. And just a cool, cool place, but it's like $200 because it was so expensive to fly there. But the cool thing about it is you just get from hop to place, just kind of see what's going on, learn some stuff, and then you arrive at your final destination. And so today, I just want to warn you, that's what's going to happen with this sermon. We're going to hop through some truths that I think it's really important. We can't miss them, but we're going to build off those. And what we're going to do is we're going to land and kind of settle on a point there. So just give you some heads up for that. So if you turn with me to Romans, I'm calling this message. I didn't have a time to come up with a cool, flashy name, so it's Lessons from Romans. If you guys can think of a cooler name, come to me after church. But Lessons from Romans chapter 13 here. I'm just going to read through this, and what I'm going to do is we're going to walk word by word through this, okay? So Romans chapter 13, and this is verse 11. And do this. And I promise you, I said this in the first service, I think I could stay just an hour on just these two words.
And you guys all panicked, stressed out that I was going to do that.
But what this tells me right from the very beginning, as soon as we open up this passage and do this, what it tells me is, guess what? We have a responsibility. Yes, Jesus Christ died on the cross. Yes, He provided victory for us. But guess what? We have a choice in the matter. He didn't save you against your will. You chose to come and become a child of the King. You chose to put off some things. You chose to do these things. And so what this is saying is, hey, church, do this. It's an admonition. And I think about it. You guys know I'm a chaplain with the city police department. And I love spending time with officers. And you guys have been keeping me quite busy for the past 2 years, so I haven't had too much time to do it. But what they used to do is call me when we were doing felony stops. So they first called me and said, hey, you want to come help us strengthen these police officers at the academy? As a chaplain, you're allowed to do that. And I thought, absolutely. I thought I was going to run around with guns and just be all cool and stuff. And no, what that meant is they would hide like fake drugs on me and send me out with these young officers for arresting. And I'd get charged with felony stuff. I mean, it was terrible. And young officers are rough, they're stressed out, so that they would like whop you on the head with the handcuffs by accident, and my wrists were all bruising. But what it reminds me of this passage is that in felony stops, and hopefully you guys don't know this whole experience, but in a felony stop, what they do is they command you, do this now. Get out of the car, do it now. Put your hands on your head, do it now. Cross your legs, do it now. Look down. Do it now. And so when I'm reading this passage, that's what I'm picturing. I'm picturing somebody saying, hey, do it now. Do it now. So that's the first thing we find, this command coming out of this scripture, for us to do it now. But what are we supposed to do? Do this. What does it say? Knowing the time. And I'm really, really big on you guys when you read scripture. I'm really big on you guys just slowing down and not missing anything. I'm going to be very honest. This is a super crucial passage. This is a super crucial little phrase. And oftentimes we just go over this. So do this, do it now. And then it says knowing the time. Knowing the time. Well, what does this mean? Let's walk into this just for a moment. Knowing the time. So I want to tell you guys this. We're on a timeline. This is my little biblical timeline that I made. It's not as accurate as it could be, but I think it'll illustrate the point. So if you see here, we have heaven and earth. That was when heaven and earth were created. We find that in Genesis. We're all aware of that. Then we have what's happening, our relatives here, the fall of man. That's why when babies come out, they're screaming and they want to kill everybody and they need to learn how to go to church and get rid of that anger. That fall of man that happened there. Next is what we just sang about this morning with all those songs, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the victory that He provided us. The veil was torn in the temple. And then Hebrews tells us that we are now in the last days. And there's many people that kind of argue and fuss about what does that look like? Is it pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, all of that stuff. But the reality is you know what? We live today in the last days. When Jesus came and died on the cross, it started then the last days. In Hebrews it tells us, in times past He spoke to the prophets. In the last days, He sent Jesus. He's going to speak to us in the Holy Spirit. So now we're in the last days. What's going to come is the return of Jesus. And I used to be a kid, I was super scared of that. Jesus would return and my mom would be gone and grandma would be gone and dad, we don't know if we'll be there. My cousin for sure would not go. I'd be there with my cousin. It was like super stressful about that. But now as a Christian, are you guys excited for the return of Jesus? Some days I wake up and I think, today please, we need to do this today. I'm ready, everybody's ready, we're good. But the return of Jesus is something we look forward to as a church. Then the new heaven and the new earth. That's a fun sermon that we can't get into today. But this passage, going back to this passage in Romans, it said, do this, know the times. Know the times. So where are we at on this? I'm saying we're about right here. And so if this is a dividing line all the way across, are we in the first half or the second half? The second half. But oftentimes a lot of us realize and we think that we're just almost invincible. We think we have all the time in the world. We're not jogged to the reality that we're on a timeline. It tells us that once a man was appointed to live, then after that is death. And then we have to face eternity, where that's going to be. So oftentimes we go to a funeral and I had the privilege of going to two this week and participating in one of them, Pauline Shelton. That's a dear lady, and the last time I saw her, she's sitting right there, just praising the Lord. And the Lord took her home in a very quick manner, and just jogged my memory to realize, you know what, we're not given tomorrow. We're not eternal. We're temporal. We're here on this earth. Even the earth. You hear all these New Age people that talk about how keeping the earth safe, and I'm aware we need to steward that with excellence, but we're going to have a new heaven and a new earth. We're not given eternity. We have to work up to that in essence and realize that Jesus Christ died on the cross for that, realizing that we're on this biblical timeline. And I just want to walk into that just for a moment. Realizing that we're on this timeline, going back to this passage here in Romans, it says this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to what? To wake out of a sleep. And so if you were to describe modern-day Christianity right now, would you describe that we are awake and we are conscious of the time we're living in? Or would you say that we're kind of asleep at the wheel? We're kind of passive in some areas. We've been chilled out to certain things. I think we need to be awake that we're living in the final days. And as we're going to find in a minute, that the devil is working overtime. Why? Because we're in the final days. If you've read the end of the book, you realize that he is actually a loser. He's lost this whole war. But what he's trying to do is just get as many people as he possibly can in these last days to fall. And we have to realize that. We can't be asleep at the wheel. Something that Ms. Bethany helps us lead in is the pro-life ministry at church. Many churches are really asleep to this idea of abortions in America. Many women have been really affected by this. Many children have lost their lives. 61 million, I believe the number is. Lost their lives to abortions. And a lot of churches are just asleep to that fact. It's uncomfortable to talk about it. I don't like talking about it. But you know what? We have to know these are the last days. We have to awake out of that sleep and get our heads out of the sand and start looking at things. And it says this, "For now our salvation is near." It's nearer than we first actually believed. "The night is far spent," or "the night is far spent and the day is at hand." So these two words here, night and day. I don't know what you picture when you read this. But again, pointing back, we've got to realize we've got to do it now. It's an encouragement right at the beginning of this passage. Do it now. Think about the times. Wake up. Then it says, "the night is far spent and the day is at hand." The picture I get in my mind is from a tree stand. You can tell a little bit of my upbringing and how I view things. It's from a tree stand. When you go to a tree stand, it is just beautiful. You walk into the woods and every little noise you hear, that the bobcat or bear or something crazy, and it ends up being asleep or whatever. But as you walk in, you sit in your tree stand. It's just pitch black. It's quiet. It's beautiful. It's peaceful. I articulate that that's why I take my vacation during hunting season, because that's the closest you can be to God. My wife disagrees, but that's neither here nor there. But as you're sitting in the woods, it's just quiet. What happens is that dark starts to slowly go away. You start to realize there's a tree here. There's a little creek here. There's this, and it just starts to come and it starts to change. And so when I picture that, I picture almost a sunset. And what this passage is saying here is the night is far spent. That night is going away. That season that we lived in is slowly going away. And guess what? We live in a very dark world, and we're called to be what? Lights. But this passage is telling us that night is far spent. The day is coming. And it says this, therefore. What do we do when we find therefores in Scripture? You figure out what it is there for, okay? I used this analogy in the first service, but if my wife said, "Hey, Gareth, blank, 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 therefore," whatever she says after that therefore, I'm probably going to get a pen and paper out. Just make sure. That's a weighted word that often points back to the conversation before. So, therefore, based on this idea of doing it now, of knowing the time, of realizing we need to wake up and not be asleep to certain things, and realize that the night is going away and there's going to be a new day, this new creation, therefore, this is something we do as a church, says, let us cast off the works of darkness. Cast off the works of darkness. Yes, Jesus Christ died on the cross for your and my sins. It was not a choice that we had. He chose me and you, and He died. We didn't deserve it. We can't earn it, yet He died for us. But there's still something that's happening here. And what I'm saying is that we have a role to play in this, and we have to cast off certain things. When you become a child of the King, you know what? You don't retain all you're going to ask Him, do you? You want to cast off? She realized, that didn't help my family. That didn't help my life experience. That didn't help these things. And there's a new creation, a renewing of your mind. And the Holy Spirit just does it naturally. When everybody gets saved, you know what I have to do? I have to give them a checklist of what they have to do now that they're a Christian, right? They have to look like this, smell like this, read like this. No, that's not how Christianity works, right? They naturally start casting off these things. As the Lord works in their heart and mind, they cast off a lot of darkness. So incredible to watch that these new Christians, that's what happens to them. Starting to cast off that. Then it says this, and let us put on, what do we put on? The armor of light. Again, I don't know what you guys picture for that. I don't know that many of you guys have worn body armor for days, but it's something you have to choose to put on. You don't just frolic around all day long with body armor. You have to put it on. Cast off all that darkness, but put on the armor of God. As Ephesians chapter 6 so wonderfully lays out, that's stuff that we have to intentionally put on. We have to put that on and realize that when I'm with the police department, I have to make a decision in the mornings to put on my body armor. Why? Because I'm going to sketchy places. And it's my decision to prepare for that. Well, guess what? Do we live in a peace time right now? If you were in Iraq right now fighting for our freedom, would you choose to put on your body armor?
I would hope so.
Well, guess what? We're at war today. We're in the final days, and the enemy is attacking us. He is trying to get as many of us as possible in these final days. I think it's 1 Peter 3:15 or something like that. Says that we be sober, be vigilant. If an adversary of your soul, he's roaring like a lion, he's seeking whom he may devour. Church, we are at war, and the one of the things we have to do is put on armor and prepare for that. Like this passage says, stop being asleep. Don't sleep at the will. Do it now. Realize that the enemy is attacking us. Put on that armor. Then I want to watch. This is what you guys watch, what the enemy does and how he attacks us. Verse 13. And let us walk properly. Walk properly, as in the day, not in revelry and in drunkenness, not in lewdness and in lust, not in strife and envy. And this is where we're going to land here. Here's our final stop here. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. We walk through verse 13 again. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and in drunkenness. And those two words, the revelry, what that means, it's a translation, that means immorality. Immorality. Next is drunkenness. Drunkenness, lewdness, and lust, strife, and envy. If you were to lump all of those things together,
what would be the word you would describe all of that?
To me, I say selfishness. Flesh. Think about it. Sexual immorality or immorality, what does that feed? The flesh. That nasty carnal nature, that's what it feeds. Drunkenness. How many of you guys have ever heard someone say, you know what, I just get drunk so that I can be around other people, right? I get drunk for the good of other people. No, in fact, they get drunk and they hurt other people. Ask them. No, I've been into those cars. I've been into those homes. Drunkenness, it's that selfishness, that carnal nature. Then it goes again and says lewdness and lust. Then it hits again sexual immorality. That selfishness. Let us not walk that way. Then it talks about strife and envy. It's a little side note, but let me give you a little trick on stopping the strife in your home and your family. You know what all 100% of strife is? Selfishness. Name one situation that was caused, that was strife, that had selfishness not in it. It's always my opinion versus your opinion. Or I had an expectation that you didn't fill. Something happened, there was tension. If we humble ourselves, as Jesus tells us to, guess what? There is no strife. We don't have to have church or family drama. There doesn't have to be strife. Oftentimes, there is selfishness that's involved with that. In this whole passage, this whole verse here in verse 13 is talking about the flesh. You know what, church? There is a war against your flesh. We're supposed to think and meditate on things that are good and pleasing and holy. We're supposed to invest in the Spirit. However, the enemy, in the last days, we got to wake up and realize, you know what he's attacking you? Your flesh. So, church, I want to ask today, what are you intentionally feeding? In verse, this, again, I read through in Romans, and I was super worried by what the Lord would tell me out of it because there's a lot of thick passages, but this passage stuck out like a sore thumb. Verse 14, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. Make no provision for it to fulfill its lusts. I told this story before, but it perfectly illustrates what we're talking about here. There's an old Indian chief, and he was talking with his son. And he was telling his son, he said, you know, there's two wolves that live inside of you. Two wolves. What he said is there's one that is good, one that helps people, that is kind, that is protector. And then there's one that is evil. One that's immoral. It kills people. It steals. It's bad. And the boy, and you can kind of see the adolescence come out. He said, well, who wins? And the grandpa said, or the dad said, whichever one you feed. Whichever one you feed wins. And so for us, looking at this passage, realizing we've got to do it now, we've got to wake up, we're in the final days, there's an enemy. What are we feeding in our life? Are we feeding the flesh? Because this passage tells us, don't make any provision for that flesh. I don't know what that looks like in your life. I don't know what the flesh means. I don't know if it's jealousy. I don't know if it's anger, if it's unforgiveness. I have no clue. But I know that if you feed that, or if you make provision, which is another way of saying an avenue for that to happen, you're going to eventually go there. For instance, if I'm trying to be on a diet, do you think that I should buy a cheesecake and put it in the fridge? That is making a provision for failure, right? But we laugh at that and think about it, but if I'm trying to succeed spiritually, are there things that I would cut out of my life, not even make provisions for? Maybe things that I build a wall and say, I'm not going there. I'm not doing that. I'm not making a provision to let my flesh come out. Again, I don't know what that looks like in your life. I know what it looks like in my life. There's certain things that I can't do. Certain things that are good, that the Lord just says, no, that's a pathway than letting your flesh get the best of you. So put a wall there. Don't make a provision to allow that flesh to rise up. So church, do it now. Wake up. Realize we're in the final days. The enemy is trying to get you in the area of flesh. But we need to be operating in the Spirit. We need to be a church that is Spirit-filled. And what that looks like is Galatians chapter 5 and verses 20, 22 through 23, I believe. That's the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, gentleness. We're supposed to be clothed in that. And we're clothed in flesh. We're kind of nasty. We're stinky. We hurt other people. But we're clothed in the fruit of the Spirit. That's what we're supposed to look like. Put on Christ. Don't make provision for that flesh. As we wrap up here, I just want to wrap up and conclude with these final statements. We need to wake up and realize the time. We need to realize that Satan is attacking in the flesh. We must put on Christ. We also must not feed the flesh. Again, I don't know what that looks like in your life.
We need to make sure, it's like we talked about last week, that we're listening to the shepherd. Make sure that we're listening to the things that invest in our spirit.
Will you pray with me? Will you pray with me? Just ask the Lord, just like prayer David prayed. Sit in my heart. And know, if there's not feeding my flesh, just let me know.
Heavenly Father,
I'm so thankful for the truth in your word. Thankful for this passage in Romans. Thankful that it speaks truth to us, that we're supposed to do it now and wake up. And I pray that all of us wake up as a church and begin to take it seriously. There were a battle for our lives. I pray, Father, you would just help us to realize that, you know, there's an enemy. And he's attacking us, and the hook he puts in us, is the hook of the flesh. And Father, I pray that we're not a fleshly people, that we're not a fleshly church, that we're Spirit-filled. That when people look at Parkway House of Prayer, they don't see a bunch of fleshly people, they see a bunch of Spirit-filled people, and they say, something is different there. Something is different. I pray that we begin to feed that Spirit inside of each one of us. That we spend time in devotion, spend time in prayer, spend time in community. I pray that we put on that armor as we go out into the world. I pray that you would check each one of our hearts right now to realize, am I feeding my flesh? Am I feeding the things that anger and stress me out or hurt other people? Or am I intentionally feeding the Spirit? I pray that you'd help us do that. This week as we walk and we worship you, I pray, Father, that you would again encourage us. If we're doing things that are appropriate, convict us if there's things that we need to change, or solidify the areas in our life that need to be solidified. So thankful for your presence, thankful for your worship, thankful for the truth in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you guys. You're dismissed. What I want to tell you is there's actually going to be a little bit of a way we're going to dismiss. You guys did this last week. I'm going to ask Brother Rick if you wouldn't mind to help me with offering. Just standing at that back door. As we exit out, what we're going to do is just exit out. If these two sections can go ahead and go. We do have to clean.